Hey Krishna, so I would like to welcome all of you for today's Bhagavad Gita second chapter discussion of the 18 chapter, 18 days, that course what we have actually registered for. So before that, I'm going to start the session. We'll have a small little prayer. Hopefully all of you can actually be the part of it. Om Ajnana Timirandhasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshur Unmilitam Yena Tasmai Shri Guruve Namaha Shri Chaitanya Mano Vishtam Sthapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Dadati Swapadantikam Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya प्रभो नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौर भक्त वृंद हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे 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 कृष्णा. सो आई एम क्वाइट वेरी मच एंथुसियास्टिक एंड फीलिंग अ लॉट ऑफ एनकरेजमेंट बाय सीइंग ऑल ऑफ यू हियर असेंबल्ड फॉर टुडेज डिस्कशन. So before I proceed, I wish to have you greeting very, very good evening. So I'm just quickly going to share the slide with you all. So this is the slide of Bhagavad Gita chapter 2. And hopefully you are able to see everything correctly, fine. Then yeah. So in previously, we have been discussing the introduction as well as the first chapter of Bhagavad Gita. And today we shall be discussing these all things that I'm going to discuss with you all very quickly. Yeah, so yes. So we'll have this all things discussion about the recap, and after that we shall be seeing chapter overview, then chapter contents, then chapter summary. Okay, so let's go dive deep into today's discussion. So I request all of you that we are going to really discuss all those elements of second chapter. So it will be very nice if you could have a notebook pen with you all. And in this way, you can actually take a lot of notes for your own life, because we have a lot of lessons also coming in between. So yeah, so let's go ahead. So before that I go, just let me just let's change this name here out. Yeah, so it goes. Yeah, so in previous session, in previous chapter, what we saw, the first thing we saw, that whole battlefield of Kurukshetra is actually being filled with the different military men led by either Pandavas or the Kauravas. And there, when the Kauravas, the 100 sons of Dhritarashtra and Pandavas, are facing to each other in fight, there Dhritarashtra is seeing, through Sanjaya, as well as Duryodhana is also seeing the whole army, and he started bragging for his own army, his own strength in front of Dronacharya. So there we saw the setting of the scene, how this whole thing's actually taken place. There we saw that how this Mahabharata is such a great epic, and this is the history of the world, history of Bharatvarsha, in which these two people, the two sections of the same family fought with each other. And in that section, we saw that how the two persons' mentalities are revealed in that section, Dhritarashtra and Duryodhana's mentalities, the Kukra mentalities are revealed. Then we saw all auspicious Krishna from 12th to 20th of sloka, how Krishna is all auspicious. And just his mere presence toward the side of Arjuna and Pandavas, actually giving the signs and victory, signs of victory for the Pandavas. Yeah, so that's what we saw, 5 signs of the victory for the Pandavas. And also we saw how Krishna is Bhaktavatsala. Krishna is defeated and conquered by his devotee's love. Okay, so that's what we saw in 21st to 27th sloka. There we can see that how Arjuna, being the servant of Krishna, out of great love, he is able to order Krishna that, Krishna, please take my chariot, and you are my chariot driver. So Krishna, even though he is the controller of the multi universes, and he is the supreme Godhead, and he is very lovingly actually taking up the orders of his servant Arjun. So that's what we saw. So Krishna takes the place of charioteer, and then we saw that problems of life that comes from 28 to 46 sloka. So here we see how, no matter how much accomplished and how much skillful one may be, problems of life are inevitable in everybody's life. Everybody's life, no matter how nicely we are studying in our academics, how nicely we are working in our house as being a housewife or being a job holder, how nicely we are working, but problems are inevitable. Here we can see that Arjuna is such an accomplished archer. He is a person who actually have the guts to defeat even his own father Indradev, as well as he has defeated even Lord Shiva. So in this way, we can see that how these problems, specifically these three types of problems, what we saw: adhyatmik klesha, because of problem, because of own body and mind; adibhautik klesha, problem because of other living entities; then adhyatmik adidevik klesha, problem because of natural disasters. So like this, these problems are always keep coming in the world, in the life of the human beings. So let's go ahead in the chapter. The chapter is the second chapter, is the one of the second largest chapter of the whole Bhagavad Gita. Second largest chapter, 72 sloka. The first largest chapter is 18th chapter. So the first section is called suffering management. Okay. So from first sloka to 10th sloka, there is suffering management. How Arjuna is fully confused, he's reeling, he's fully stressful. And in that condition, he is actually approaching Krishna and he is asking, what shall I do? So then we will see that how Krishna is actually taking up the case of Arjuna. He's very seriously chastising Arjuna at first time. After that, he is revealing his identity crisis and is solving the identity crisis of Arjuna at first time. Okay, then we will see how enjoyment through prescribed duties can be gotten. Okay, how prescribed duties can give us the bodily comfort and enjoyment. And fourth one is perfection through prescribed duties. How the same prescribed duties, the skill and the way of doing is different. When it is different, then it can give us the perfection, the siddhi, by doing prescribed duty. That's called Sanatana Dharma. At last, we shall be seeing symptoms of perfected and blissful soul. Okay, that's very wonderful section of today's discussion. So let's go ahead into the chapter, the section one, the bhag one. This is called quick suffering management. So here we see Arjuna, even though such a great accomplished archer of the whole world, he is having such a big crisis of indecisiveness. He has come on the battlefield of Kurukshetra to fight, and there, just onset of war, he is perfectly puzzled, stressed out, indecisive, what to do, what not to do, whether to fight or not to fight. So this is actually the suffering, perplexities. So the suffering management is actually here dealt by Krishna. I mean, so what happens, this Arjuna, before, from the beginning of this chapter, he starts talking with Krishna a friendly way, just like a friend. And Krishna also suggests him like a friend. Krishna tells him, don't speak like an Arya, those who are not Aryans. Don't speak like that. You are Arya. Don't get into this miserly weakness. You are not fit to get that. So Arjuna further tells that, how I can kill my, my grandsires, my spiritual masters? How I can take weapons against them? So after that, what happens? he's fully puzzled, not able to understand what to do, what not to do. In those conditions, Arjuna surrenders to Krishna. Okay, so there very wonderful things takes place. So that we will be able to see that later. So in this chapter, the first time this particular term has been coined out by Vyasadeva, and that is called Sri Bhagavan Vacha. Okay, so here we see wherever Dhritarashtra says, then it is called Dhritarashtra Vacha. When Sanjaya says Sanjaya Vacha, when Arjuna says Arjuna Vacha, but when Krishna says, it is not told Krishna Vacha, but rather it is told Sri Bhagavan Vacha. Okay, so why it is so? Why Krishna is called to Bhagavan here? In whole Vedas, we have seen that wherever Krishna Narayana speaks out, then his name is not attributed, but the designation of Bhagavan to be attributed, that people could understand Bhagavan is Krishna. Okay, so who is called God? Who is called Bhagavan? Bhagavan is the person who is the supreme creator of the whole existence. He's the supreme controller of that, and also he's a supreme enjoyer of that. Of course, we are also tiny creators, tiny controllers, and tiny enjoyers. Maybe of some flat or some building or some form. But we cannot be the supreme creator, supreme controller, and supreme enjoyer. We cannot be. Of course, that is also in the constant of time. We can be creator, we can be controller, tiny control, we can be tiny enjoyer for some time being, but not for the time eternity. But that person who is the supreme creator for time eternity, supreme controller for time eternity, supreme enjoyer for time eternity, the whole universe, unlike such many, many universes, that person is called Bhagwan. And also very, very interesting that there is definition of Bhagwan. You'll very much enlighten and gladden to know about the definition of Bhagwan, which is actually given in Vishnu Puran by Parasar Muni. Okay, so Parasar Muni tells what is the definition of Bhagwan. He tells Aishwaryasya Samadgrasya Viryasya Aishasya Shriya Jnana Vairagyam Yasya Sannam Bhaga Itinganaha. He tells that a person can be called to be God if he is having six opulences in full. So what is the first opulence? He should be supremely wealthy. If somebody can claim that I'm the supremely wealthiest person in the world, nobody is wealthier than me, I am a supreme wealthy person. Okay, so he can be called to be God. Somebody can say that he's crorepati, somebody can say he's arabpati, and somebody can tell that he has trillions or trillions of money. But nobody can say that all that riches, all that money is belonging to me. Or he cannot say that I am Lakshmipati. Okay. So there is only one person he can say that I am Lakshmipati, and who can claim that all that riches belongs to me and that person. And he is called Narayana or Krishna. Okay. So Aishwarya, Sashamangrasya, Aishwarya, the first one, Aishwarya. So second is called supremely strong. Anyone who can claim that I am supremely strong person, nobody is more stronger than me, then he can be called to be God. Okay, so we know when Krishna was there in his live pastimes after descending from Vaikuntha in this world, just 5,000 years ago, in Vrindavan, he lifted the Govardhan hill, such a huge hill, for 7 days and 7 nights on his finger, his small little finger. So this is called the God, the supremely strong. And he claims in Bhagavad Gita also, Mattah Paratram Na Anyat. No, there is nothing in this world which is more superior and stronger than Krishna. Okay. So that person can be called to be God. And third one is called most famous. The person who is God, he should be most famous throughout the whole universe. Okay. And not only one universe, but multi universes, he should be famous. And not only multi these universes, but in his spiritual world also, he should be famous. So there is only one person, he's supremely famous, and people around the globe are ready and busy glorifying this person. And his name is Krishna. Okay, he's supremely famous. When he steals butter, then it's called makanchor. But when we steal anything ourselves, when we steal, then we are put handcuffs and put behind the bars. Okay. So in this way, he's supreme famous. He's supremely famous as the most celebrated speaker of Bhagavad Gita. That even people around the globe, irrespective of caste, creed, nationality, they're learning, they're reading Bhagavad Gita is spoken by the Supreme Godhead, Krishna. Okay. So this is called the third opulence, supremely famous. Yasha, Shriya, Yasha, he is supremely famous. So next, the fourth bhaga or the fourth opulence of God is he's supremely beautiful. The person who can say that I am supremely beautiful, he can be called to be God. Okay, so we know we have so many different types of beautiful, beautiful things around. Okay, so somebody could be very handsome. Somebody could be Mr. India, or somebody could be Miss Universe or Miss India or whatever. But they cannot be kept, designation for whole of their life. Every year the Miss India or Mr. India, or everything changes, right? Okay, so this beauty of Supreme God is not only for a particular species, like a human male can attract a human female, and human female can attract a human male. But Supreme God is a personality. He attracts everyone practically. Okay. He attracts the cows. He attracts the birds. He attracts the even inanimate things. Animate, inanimate, everything is attracted by him. This is the history that when Krishna was in Vrindavan, he was playing his very sweet flute. By his sweet flute sound, the animated things used to stop. Those things which are actually running, they used to get stopped. And those things which are actually stopped, I mean, there's no moment, they used to start running. Just like Yamuna used to just get stuck by hearing the beautiful sound vibration coming from the flute. And the different rocks used to melt and start running by hearing the sweet melodious sound of Krishna's flute. And not only human beings used to get attracted with Krishna, but all birds, deers, cuckoos, cows, all different species, even trees, they used to get attracted with Supreme Godhead Krishna. Okay, so this is called the fourth opulence of Bhagwan. If somebody can say that I am supremely beautiful, then he can be called to be God. And the penultimate one, the supreme knower. He is the supreme knower. He knows everything happening in this world, practically in every atom. He is, another name is called Vishnu, means the person who is actually having his access to each and every atom. Each and every atom he has access. He has the knowledge of what's happening in every atom. And forget about what's happening in everybody, all of us, in our heart. He knows everything. And of course, his most celebrated Bhagavad Gita. He didn't require practice. That's like I'm speaking here. So I had a practice. I just made some PPT, I did some workout, seeing through Bhagavad Gita what Krishna has told in second chapter. Then I'm able to speak in front of you all. But for Krishna, it doesn't require that, now he's going to speak for 1.5 hour whole Bhagavad Gita, and then he has to cram all the materials, and he has to see that what he has spoken some millions of years before to Vivashvan Sun God. No, not like that. He is supremely knower. Whatever he speaks is called Vedas. Okay, so this is called the fifth opulence of the Supreme Godhead, which makes a man supreme God. Which gives the definition of supreme God. No man can become a God, but if somebody claims and somebody shows these type of attributes, that person can be called to be God. Why I'm telling this? Because India, specifically India, is called the factory of gods. Every now and then, this India produces God. Anybody comes with a beard, and anybody comes with some fancy lifestyle, they claim themselves to be God. I am God. I am the incarnation of Supreme Godhead. I am Kalki or something. So people are there in this world, they are actually getting fooled by them. And in this way, they themselves are getting cheated. Of course, the person who is cheating, they're also getting cheated. But plenty of people, because of lack of knowledge, they get cheated. So we must have this understanding what it's called to be Bhagwan. And the sixth opulence is called renunciation. Means even though having this, all those attributes, the opulences, Supreme God is perfectly renounced. He is not attached with all things. He won't tell every time and tells all those mines of diamonds, rubies, and gold belongs to me. You people don't take that. No, he don't tell that. We know that how in battlefield of Kurukshetra, he actually taken the position of being a charioteer of Arjun. So this is his opulence of renouncing. Like if you are like in honor of a particular car and you have a driver, you can never tell your driver that you sit back today, let me drive you. Okay. So driver is always drive you, but you seldom say this type of thing. But Krishna, out of his great kindness, is renounced. When he was a small little child, his father used to tell, Krishna, can you please get my chappal, that sandal? So Krishna, very like, no, he will just like, he will walk like he don't know anything and he's having very less power. Somehow that he lift it and he'll put it upon his head. And after that, he slowly come in front of his father and he will just put it there, down in front of him. So the person who's having these all six opulences, he can be called to be God. Okay. So now let's go ahead again diving inside the flow of second chapter of Bhagavad Gita. So here we see Arjuna's further indecisiveness. What he tells, how can I kill my seniors like Drona? And he tells, I will better live by begging, Arjuna, Krishna. Better I will live by begging, because there are so many yogis and sannyasis, they go out and they just beg and they just live by begging. What's wrong with that? Why to go into such a messy war, killing each other and shedding so much of blood? I'm done with the kingdom ruling or these different things. I'll go and take begging, okay, as my profession. So then we have the life lesson here. Why he's asking like this type of indecisiveness? Why he's getting into this? Because he's having attachment with his relatives, bodily attachment. Okay, so the life lesson for all of us right here is decision making hampered by attachment. If we want to take decisions in our life, we have to keep all those silly attachments aside. We have to see the higher goals. Then we can take decisions without attachment, and then we can proceed in our life. Otherwise, if we take all those silly attachment, leaving aside the higher superior causes, then we can never take a very prompt decision in our life. Okay, so now let's go ahead. This is actually the key sloka of this section of this particular chapter, Bhagavad Gita, second chapter. This very wonderful sloka in which Arjuna surrenders to Krishna, telling that I am fool, I'm getting this type of indecision because of the weakness of my heart. Oh Krishna, please tell me what is best for me to do. Okay, so he tells, Karpanya dosho pahata swabhava prichhami tvam dharma sammoda chetaha yashreya shanishchitam bruhitanme sisyasteham shadhimam tvam prapannam. He tells, now I'm confused about my duty and have lost all composure because of miserly weakness. In this condition, I am asking you to tell me for certain what is best for me. Now I am your disciple and a soul surrender unto you. Please instruct me. Okay. So here we see this is the surrenderance of Arjuna. Even though he is the one of the very sweet friend of Krishna, he surrenders to Krishna just like disciple, I mean a shishya. Okay, so what he tells his own weakness. Okay, so when we surrender in front of Krishna, we don't tell our qualities, how great we are. Rather, we tell our weakness. These are the weaknesses, and because of that, I am surrendering unto you, O Krishna. And he reveals his heart. What is his problem? What is his problem that he's having this attachment with his kinsman's body, and he's getting indecisiveness because of weakness of heart. Okay. So he's revealing his heart. What is wrong with me? What is wrong with me? He's just expressing everything in front of Krishna. And he also tells Krishna, even though I get the whole sovereignty of my kingdom on the Bharatvarsha, even though I become the king of the whole world, still I cannot remove the grief. And no matter my all spiritual masters like Drona, Kripa, Charya, Bhishma, they all are assembled here, no one can remove this problem of mine. Okay. So he is exclusively taking shelter of Krishna. Taking shelter of Krishna, thinking that there is no hope other than going and asking Krishna what to be done in this situation. Okay, so now what happens because of this all affirmations, that there is a change in relationship between the friends, it turns to being a relationship of a guru and a disciple. Okay, that's great. That's great. When there is a change in relationship, then there can be some exchange of instructions and some exchange of service. Okay, so the things comes from up to down. It won't flow in the same potential platform. Okay, so for expecting best beneficial instructions, he asks, what is best for me? Please tell. I'm not able to figure out. Please tell me what is best for me. I'm accepting you to be my spiritual master guru. And in this way, Arjuna surrenders to Krishna very confidently that whatever Krishna will tell, that is going to be perfectly correct for me. Okay. So in this way, because Arjuna is knowing who is Krishna, that's why he tells, hey, Achyuta, the person who never falls down, oh, Rishikesha, the person who is knowing what is happening in everyone's mind and senses, and he is controller of senses. So knowing the position of Krishna, Arjuna surrenders. Okay. Then we have the life lesson, very, very crucial life lesson for all of us. For most beneficial inquiries in life, we must approach Krishna or his true representatives. If we really want to do something good, Shreya, for, in our own life. Okay. So now let's go ahead to section 2. So we completed very successfully section 1. Let's go ahead to section 2. Now here Krishna starts instructing Arjuna, enlightening Arjuna in different way. The first way what he takes up, that's called Sankhya, or solving the identity crisis, or analyzing the whole system of human being into two ways, the temporary and eternal, or body and soul. Okay, so this identity crisis he discussed in 11th to 13th sloka, and this is the key words of this particular section. Second chapter, 13th sloka. Dehino asmin yatha dehe kaumaram yauvanam jara tatha dehantara praptir dhiras tatrana muhiyati. Krishna tells that embodied souls continually passes from this body, in this body, from boyhood to youthhood, from youthhood to old age. And soul, after old age, he gets into a phase called death. Okay, in death, what happens? He changes the body altogether. Okay, so in these situations, those who are composed people, those who are sober person, they won't get bewildered. Krishna tells Arjuna. So he tells the two people, dehi means the person who is there in the deha, in the body. Okay, he is dehi, the soul, and deha means the body. Okay, that's very quite simple Sanskrit words. So identity crisis solved. So very quickly, we shall go ahead with this. What is this, the concept of identity of ourselves, the human beings, or anybody rather? Okay, identity crisis. The first thing is that outwardly we are able to see, if we see someone, then first we see what? The body, the gross body, what we see, which we can touch, which we can see by our this fleshy eyes. Okay, so this body is very, very temporary and it's always changing. Okay, medically has been also proven this body of ours, which is actually made of five elements earth, water, fire, air, ether. So there are the five constituents of this body: earth, water, fire, air, ether. This is called gross body, which is always changing. In 7 years, every cell of our body will get changed perfectly. Whatever cells we have now, if you live most further 7 years, then nothing will be there. All those matters now will be changed perfectly. Okay, so in every 7 years, the whole body changes. Okay, so but we are the same person. So inside that body, there is another body that is also changing. There are two bodies, and this is called subtle body. Okay, the subtle body is made up of three things also: mind, intelligence, and false ego. These are three things: mana, buddhi, and ahankara. By these three things, this subtle mind is, subtle body is made for all of us. And at last, inside the subtle body and the gross body, there is a person. There is a person who never changes. Okay, and that person is called soul. Okay, so this soul is made up of also three things: Sat, Chit, and Ananda. Sat means he's eternal. Chit means he's all cognizant. He's having the hankering to know things around. And also he is full with bliss and Ananda. Okay, so this is called soul. So just an example, in cold season, sometimes we wear some very heavy, you know, gown or coat. And inside we have a small little thin shirt. And inside the body is actually. So similarly, this gross body is just like a very thick coat. And inside there is a thin shirt, just like this, this one, a subtle body. And inside we are the soul. Okay. So this soul is the person who never changes. Just like we have been there in our child body. We sometimes, our parents show us like, oh, see, this is you. You know, when you were just 3 years old, this is you. Oh, we just get confused. What? How you used to look like that? A small little boy. Or after that, we get grow a little more. Then we may remember like, yeah, when we were just 10 years old and 12 years old, those photos we see, then we could remember, yeah, I was looking like that before. Yeah, something like that. But the body has been completely changed. But we are able to know that we are the same person, right? So what is that element? What is that component? What is the factor which is keeping us to, I mean, the same person? That is called soul, okay? So we are soul. We are Atma. We are not this body, what we are seeing every day on the mirror. Okay. So we are soul, which is made up of Sat, Chit, Ananda, and we are always there, permanent, having no depreciation, no decay, and no death. And also there is no birth of the soul. Okay. So now let's go ahead with some scientific proofs of the existence of the soul. So this is the common sense, usually. You know, and India, specifically in India, somebody passes away. I mean, somebody dies. You know, somebody dies, we never say. But we say someone has passes away. Then what do we say? Like somebody, maybe his name is Sri Ram Babu. We say Sri Ram Babu has left his body last year. Okay. And in different languages, we say the same thing. Just like in Hindi, we say Sri Ram Babu pichle saal sharir chhod gaye, hai na? So, and in Bangla also, we say similarly, Sri Ram Babu got washer sharir rakhlen. So like this, we see this Ram Babu is different than the body. It means Ram Babu was a person who is not body. It means he left the body and he went out. But what we were saying to be Ram Babu, the person, that body that is still there. Is still there lying, but without any moment. Means Ram Babu was not the body. We had never seen rather the Ram Babu. Who was Ram Babu? Ram Babu has left the body. Means the Ram Babu is the soul. Okay, that person, the real, that Ram Babu, or the real self. Okay, so now let's go into some scientific proofs of existence of the soul. There are many different researches had been done in the medical field as well as in the academia, throughout the different universities around the globe. Okay, so some very typical different typical type of experiences which are actually have been noted throughout the years. That's called ND and OB experiences. ND means near death experience, and OB means out of body experience. Okay, so this is actually the experiences of different patients, specifically heart patients, when they're actually operated in OT. And many a times they had been actually revived from death. Many times their heart curve, that ECG makes like horizontal without giving any adult alterations. And after that, some again they have revived. So they have been actually perceiving and experiencing what's called the near-death experience. They have been coming out from the depth. And what is actually into this near-death experience is mainly OBE, means out-of-body experiences, in which the soul takes off from the body, leaves the body, and see, hovers around in the ceilings or somewhere above the building, and he see what's happening around. Many times, it has been seen that he's seeing all those operation procedures, what's happening. And after coming out, I mean, after going into the body and again getting revived, he tells everything what doctors has actually would be doing and had been doing till now. So specifically this Dr. Pim Van Lommel, he has given very extensive research, done very great extensive research into this field. And he has told also that in USA, more than 9 million people had NDE. And also in Netherlands, only Netherlands, 6 lakh people had NDE. And in Europe, more than 20 million people had NDE, near-death experiences, okay? So in which people can actually see themselves, I mean, see their body coming out from the body, seeing the body operated. And then we have next reincarnation researches, and specifically the people, into it, specifically these two people are very much noted, Dr. Ian Stevenson and Dr. Jim Tucker. Okay, so they have researched some thousands of cases, thousands of spontaneous reincarnation cases, in which the kids, small little girls of 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, they could remember their past lives, and they can regret and they can regress their memory, and they can go into their past lives and they can tell that what they were in the past life. Okay, so one of them is also this had come into a notice of world. This person is called James Huston. Okay, this person James Huston reincarnated as James Leninger. That's what we were able to see here. And from very beginning of his childhood, this James Leninger, what you're able to see here, he had a great fascination for fighter planes. He used to always say different words that their parents, they're not able to understand what he's speaking. Cockpit and bombs and different types of cabins and all this stuff. His parents were puzzled why he's speaking like this. And sometimes he used to be in dream and he used to speak like this. Oh, fight, fire, there is attack and something like that. So different type of things. So later on, some more researches were done upon his life. And it was found that yes, in Second World War, there was a person. His name was also James. And he has been actually suited by Japanese in Second World War. And he tells that, yeah, I was suited by Japanese. And he tells that which phalanx of which battalion of the air force he was there. So that's a natoma. He was remembering everything, and that was found. Yes, there was something called natoma army that in which he was actually working, and he was suited. So like this, there are many researches have been done, and usually people they remember till 10 years, 8 years, and after that they. Automatically they won't care about that, all those things. So it just stays in the subconscious mind. Many times the people, they are able to figure out while they are sleeping in a dreaming situation. They go at some places where they had never been in this life. Especially it happens to me also. So maybe some of you also would have this different types of experiences. So we see here that if we are attached to the body, what Arjuna is in the situation, then what happens to him? Then Krishna tells that, see Arjuna, if you are still thinking that your relatives are very important for you, your relatives' body is important for you, but still for doing your duties, you should tolerate your dualities. You should tolerate dualities. What are the dualities? Sometimes you feel hot, sometimes you feel cold, sometimes you feel comfortable, sometimes we feel miseries. So these are the dualities of the world, which is actually happening just by our sense perceptions of skin. Okay, so the same water what we are feeling now in cold season to be very chilly, very distressful, but the same water gives a lot of pleasure in summer season. Okay, but water is same. So in this condition, while executing your duty of being a Kshatriya, you must tolerate them. Okay, so this is actually temporary. Hot is there, it will go away. Cold is there, it will go away. You have comfort, that will also go away. You have misery, that will also go away. Everything is temporary. So while performing your duties, become very equipoised and tolerate it. Okay, because they are temporary. So we have life lesson. We have the life lesson for all of us. What is that? You can be really happy only when you are satisfied. You means the soul is satisfied. Many people around the globe, we see, they do so many things for the body, but inside the soul, they themselves are crying inside. They're having smiling faces, but inside, they themselves are perfectly unsatisfied. Just like a parrot inside the cage, a person is painting the cage very nicely with golden paints and all stuff, but not feeding the parrot inside the cage, the parrot will slowly die. Of course, this is a situation of modern society in which the soul is not given any nourishment, any feed, so that it can remain healthy. And they are simply polishing the body. And because of that, they are always unsatisfied. They are always, because of that, trifles. There are different types of problems in the world just because of the unsatisfaction of the soul. Okay, now let's go ahead. Successfully, we completed the second section. Section third, in which we will see happiness through prescribed duties. Okay, that's called Swadharma. By our own activities, what we can get? We can get comfortable life at least. Okay, we have to work, of course, but for some time being, of course, we will get comfortable life by doing our prescribed duties. That's what Krishna tells Arjuna. Even though for getting your comforts, I mean the bodily comforts, you must do your duties, Arjuna. He tells, Hato va prapsasi swargam, jitva va bhakshase mahin. Tasmad uttishta kaunteya yudhaya krita nishchaya. It tells, if you will fight, you will be killed, then you will go to heavens. If you will be killed, you will go to heavens, and if you will die, I mean, if you will win, then you will be ruling in Hastinapur. The whole Aryavart will be able to rule, and you will enjoy. So even to get your comforts, material comforts, you need to work, okay? You need to fight. That's what your duty is. Okay, so now let's go ahead. What's prescribed duty means? Swadharma. What is called Swadharma means doing prescribed duties according to Vedas. Okay, so first, what attributes to be the Swadharma in which people they work and their purpose of work is to get heavenly planet or heavenly kingdom or heavenly comfort. Okay, then second, here we see for the case of Arjuna, Krishna tells that if you will perform your duties, then you will no more incur sins. Okay? So sin will not touch you in this situation. And third, he says that if you will win or if you will die, in both cases, you will get glory. But if you will run away from here by imitating occupation of a beggar or a sannyasi, then whole world will spit upon you. They will not tell that you were feeling compassionate toward the relatives, and they will tell your glory. No, they will say that he was a coward man. Kayar, what we say in his Hindi. So then they will tell that person was actually the friend of Krishna. Krishna friend can work like that. So don't get into this. By doing a prescribed duty, you will get glories. Okay, that's what many times we work also for, what, to get glory, that how great we are, how nicely we are working, how nice stuff we have, buildings, bungalow and all the stuff. Okay, so to get glories. Okay, next is what's called freedom from criticism. That's what we just now see. That's now saw. So people not criticize us. And fifth one is called, you will enjoy kingdom if you'll win. Okay, so there are five things that a person get when he actually doing his prescribed duty. That's called Swadharma. Okay, so we have a life lesson here. better than running away from responsibilities, better than running away from responsibility for nothing is to do our duty very diligently. Okay, now successfully we have completed the third section. We are there in the fourth section. That's called perfection through prescribed duties. And this is called Sanatan Dharma. Very, 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 very important section of our today's discussion. So just before, we have Swadharma, means performing our duties for bodily comforts and bodily enjoyment, but here performing our duties for perfection. Duties are same, but one is called to be Swadharma and another will be called to be Sanatan Dharma. And how this works, let's go ahead. So what is this Sanatan Dharma? Prescribed duties with offered result for the divine cause or the highest cause. Okay, so what it gives to the people, those who perform this, it burns all the sin of the history of the person. The Sanatan Dharma can burn all the sins. Okay, at the place where we saw that Swadharma can get into no more sin, but here Sanatan Dharma can burn all the sins in the history of the karmic history of the man or woman. So second is called eternal bank account. Any activity done for Sanatan Dharma will be eternally kept for you. It will not be lost, right? Like we amass a lot of money in this world, but if we'll die in next life we come, then we cannot claim those, all those riches what we have actually deposited in the bank. We cannot go and claim SBI that, oh, last life I was this man, this Mr. this, and can you give that money to me? We cannot say that. Or else we have done our PhD degree or whatever degree, and the next life we come, we cannot just go in university that I'm the same person, you know, I'm the same person who had been studying in this university and I had got this degree and please give me that degree. No, we cannot say that. But if we perform Sanatan Dharma, the credit that is we have actually amassed, that will be there eternally with us. Okay, so that's called eternal bank account. Progress will be intact for us. Third is called focus. If you want really a focused life in your life, a focus in your life, then we must perform Sanatan Dharma. That's actually a magic trick for all of us to learn. Okay, this is called Vyavasaya Atmika Buddhi, resolute focus in life, the person who performs Sanatan Dharma. Okay, now fourth is called one-stop destination. The person who performs Sanatan Dharma, they get everything at one place. They don't need to go to different places. That's like a supermarket. You go to supermarket, you'll get everything at one place. That's like in Bhagavad Gita, there is an example. If you want to get water, a fresh water, very cooling, soothing, quenching thirst water, then you need to go to very wonderful flowing river and you have to get, you have to fetch water from there. You don't need to go to different ponds and get water. Okay, so Sanatan Dharma is called one-stop destination. Then fifth is called, this will get you to liberation from birth and death. This is called Sanatan Dharma, what Krishna is going to tell. So very, very famous sloka. Must be, most of you might have remembered this. 47 sloka. Karmanneva adhikaraste ma phale shukadachana ma karma phale heturbhu ma te sangastu karmani. So Krishna tells to Arjuna, Arjuna, you do your activities, but the activities will bear some fruits. Don't consider yourself to be the cause of that fruit. And that fruit has to be offered to me. Ma karma phal heturbhu ma te sangastu karmani. When you are not putting yourself as to be the cause of the fruit, at the same time, you should not think that why should I work at the place. Okay. So never consider yourself the cause or result of your activity. Never be attached to not doing your duty. Okay, so now we have the call to action for all of us. This is call to action. What is that? We should keep all abominable acts far away. And that's why Krishna tells Arjuna that buddhiyukta jahatiha ubhay sukrita duskritau, and he says that avaram karma, we have to leave all those abominable activity, has to be thrown out. Then he tells, act as a duty without considering loss or gain. When abominable activities are out, do your duty with great focus and attention without considering what will happen in the future, loss or gain. And third, take shelter of Krishna for offering the fruit of your action. Whatever good or bad fruits comes, everything should be offered to Krishna. That's the way of called Sanatana Dharma. So now we have a life lesson. Key to perfected life is in offering the fruit of action to Krishna. Okay, for all of us. Key to perfect life and key to a perfect life is in offering the fruit of action to Krishna. Now we are in our last section of our today's discussion, perfected and jubilant life, symptoms of performing Sanatana Dharma. Okay, so this is the key sloka of this section, 59 sloka of second chapter. Vishaya vinivartante niraharasya dehinah rasavarjam rasopiyasya param drishtva nivartate. Embodied soul may be restricted from sense enjoyment through the test for sense objects remains, but seizing such engagements by experiencing a higher test is fixed in consciousness. Okay, so what is this? Many times in this all concepts seems very lofty. Okay, that's fine. No, fine. We should leave out wrong things. No, we should do good things. We should do our prescribed duties. But most often, people they commit to different activities which are actually not worthy to be done, right? So, how to actually cope up with that? That's why Krishna tells Arjuna, "Rasa varjam rasopiyasya." If we get better enjoyment, then you can leave out the obnoxious and inferior enjoyment, right? If you get superior enjoyment, if you get, suppose kheer, in India, kheer is very famous, the cold kheer, which is actually put in freeze for one night, and in morning time you're tasting it, it's like perfect nectar. So somebody gives you kheer, and somebody has given you before a Kerala sabji. So automatically when you have the kheer, you'll opt for the kheer, right? And Kerala sabji automatically gone. Similarly, many a time people, they actually get caught up with different sinful activities like smoking, like gambling, like so on so forth. There are many, many, which I'll be discussing further. But if we'll give the more enjoyable process in which they will get more happiness, more nourishment, more enrichment, so then they can actually leave those sinful tendencies away, leave them out. So this is actually, we have a very wonderful lesson for all of us to learn. So leaving bad drives, the life lesson for us, leaving bad drives automatically take place when we release higher test with worthy engagements. Okay, so it is just like putting something in a void. As we say, we have the proverb that empty mind is devil's workshop. Empty mind is devil's workshop. So in that empty mind, there should be always good thing put. If nothing is there, then all crap, all those nonsense things will go and take place. That's what we see. If we keep some, maybe one room of our flat without engaging into any activity into that and doing nothing, just keep it there, just lock for 1 month. Automatically you see that whole room has been perfectly dusted. So much of dust, so much of cobwebs, air there, everything has gone topsy-turvy. Why? Because that room was not used. But if it would have been used for a better purpose, some activity, something, then it would have been clean, maintained, everything nice. Okay, similarly, for our mind also, we should always deliberately think that how the good values can be put into that. And what could be the best inspiration and source for putting good values other than Srimad Bhagavad Gita? And all of you are so fortunate to subscribe to this wonderful course of Bhagavad Gita to get into such a wonderful concept of Bhagavad Gita which has been actually spoken by Supreme Lord Krishna. Okay, so now we are at the last section of the last section. Okay, so this very, very important section, they're called 8 steps of destruction for one who does not realize the higher test. So Arjuna is advised by Krishna that Krishna, Arjuna, you must realize the higher test if you want to come out from the different like activities which are actually not your duties. So, but you can be stopped doing those all duties if you get into this chain of destruction. So what is that chain of destruction? Very, very important to know. He tells in 62nd and 63rd shloka, Krishna tells that if you think about the senses, the sense objects, then what will happen? Attachment will arise. Dhyayate vishyan punsaha sangasteshu padayate. The attachment will increase. And by the attachment, what will happen? The third thing will take place. That's called lust will develop. And after lust, what will develop? Anger will arise. Like automatically, anger will arise. And after anger, you will be perfectly illusioned. That was sammoha. From anger, delusion will take place, right? And after delusion, you will lose all your memories. Boom. Everything will just going away. You will not remember anything. And after that, intelligence will be lost, and that will lead to complete destruction. So this is called national highway of complete destruction. Okay. So what is that? We commonly we see in our day-to-day life also. Sometimes we, you know, like unduly we get into some relationships and we start contemplating, then we get attachment, and after that wrong attachment gets into so much of desires, and after that we get into anger. The desires, if that get fulfilled, then it gets greed. It's get into greed. But if not fulfilled, because greed having no limit, and we cannot satisfy the greed. We cannot satisfy the greed. Greed has to turn into anger for sure. And when anger comes, then there is delusion. There is perfectly delusion that what is good, what is bad, people are not able to understand. And in that situation, nothing stays in the brain. There it undergoes a process called memory loss, whatever way, short term or long term memory loss, that memory loss takes place, and buddhi, the intelligence, is finished to take decision. There is no decision making capacity for that person, and in that situation, most of the time, people, they fall out from the life and they get into a destruction, life destruction. Okay, so they go into maybe lower form of life, and they get a hellish life. Even though in this life only they make their life hellish because of this section, this whole chain that was actually they undergo. So we have a life lesson for all of us. By stopping the vicious chain at contemplation stage, at the first stage one needs to be stopped, through putting higher thoughts of Krishna. Makes one jubilant, perfect, and free from all dangers. Okay, so what's better thing to be contemplated other than Krishna? He is such a beautiful person. Okay, so try remembering Krishna, this is our call to action, second chapter. Try remembering Krishna the difficult terms while meticulously performing your duties. Okay, and now we are at the end of our today's discussion. We shall be seeing very quickly summary of chapter second. So we saw suffering management, in which we saw that decision making is thwarted by attachment, by mundane attachment. For best advice on our life, we must submit to Krishna and his true representatives. Then we saw that how Krishna is actually taking Arjuna through enlightenment slowly. First, he solves the identity crisis. What he tells that you can be really happy only when you are satisfied. And you are what? You are soul. Okay. So he tells what is you. Who are we? He not only tells Arjuna, but rather to the whole human race who are going to come in the next consecutive years of Kali Yuga. Actually, the whole Bhagavad Gita for all of us. So Krishna, keeping Arjuna to be the instrument, he teaches us that we must know first that we are not this body, we are soul. Okay, then now third comes, what is called enjoyment through prescribed duties. Better than running away from our prescribed duties, imitating others, we must perform our duty very diligently, what Krishna tells to Arjuna. And then we have called Sanatana Dharma. Key to perfected life is in offering the fruits to Krishna of our activities. Okay, and then we have last, leaving bad drives by releasing higher test. Okay, testing nectar, living a bitter guard. Okay, so in this way we completed today. And the last what is called stop vicious cycle with thinking about Krishna. That's what at last we saw, the 8 consecutive stages of destruction. Okay, that we can stop by stopping that whole cycle at the first stage. That's called contemplation, by thinking about something marvelous, something beautiful, and what is beautiful, better beautiful than Krishna. Okay, so let's go ahead Yeah, that's what we are at the end of our today's discussion. Wish you an enlightened, jubilant life. Thank you so much. So if you have any question, if you have any queries, so you can just write.